a nature and wildlife journey. Experience the extremes of Southern Africa's landscapes on this journey from Cape Town to the thunderous Victoria Falls. Navigate lush waterways in the enigmatic Okavango Delta, cruise past elephants and birds on the Chobe River, climb giant sand dunes, camp among the sounds of Africa's wildlife, and spot big cats, rhino, zebra and antelope on Etosha National Park's arid plains. Meet the people who make their homes here, from cheerful Delta Mokoro Polars to the fascinating Sun Bushmen. Get ready for this unforgettable journey of contrasts. With its stunning coastline, dominating mountain and modern cityscape, Cape Town is one of Africa's most appealing cities. With vineyards on its doorstep, adventure activities around every other corner, plenty of restaurants and cafes to while away the time, Cape Town is a very easy city to spend some extra time in. Table Mountain National Park. The park forms part of the Cape Floral Region, a World Heritage Site. It includes the majestic Table Mountain chain, which stretches from Signal Hill to Cape Point and the coastlines of the Cape Peninsula. This natural World Heritage Site and natural new Seven Wonder of the World is a haven of magnificent mountains plunging into crystal seas fringed with bleached white sands of the Cape Peninsula. Arguably one of the most well-known mountains in Africa, Table Mountain provides a magnificent backdrop to cosmopolitan Cape Town and now boasts the accolade of new Seven Wonders of Nature. Famous for the tablecloth of clouds that pour endlessly down its slopes when the southeaster blows, this is a mountain of many moods and offers walkers and hikers a range of routes that vary from light strolls to rigorous hikes. You decide whether you want to reach the summit and revel in spectacular views of the city, or simply stroll along in the cool shade of the indigenous forest. Whichever you choose, you won't be disappointed. Please remember that even though it is in an urban setting, it is still a wild mountain that offers challenging climbs and sheer cliffs. So be aware of where you intend to walk and always ensure that you stick to the path and are kitted out for cold weather. At the tip of the Cape Peninsula, 60 kilometers southwest of Cape Town, lies Cape Point, a nature reserve within the Table Mountain National Park, a declared Natural World Heritage Site. Encompassing 7,750 hectares of rich and varied flora and fauna, abounding with buck, baboons and Cape Mountain zebra, as well as over 250 species of birds, Cape Point is a nature enthusiast paradise. Rugged rocks and sheer cliffs towering more than 200 meters above the sea and cutting deep into the ocean provide a spectacular background for the park's rich biodiversity. Cape Point falls within the southern section of Table Mountain National Park. The natural vegetation of the area, fynbos, comprises the smallest but richest of the world's six floral kingdoms. The scenic beauty of Cape Point is not its sole allure. It is also an international icon of great historical interest, with many a visitor drawn to the area because of its rich maritime history. Named the Cape of Storms by Bartolomeo Dias in 1488, the point was treated with respect by sailors for centuries. By day it was a navigational landmark, and by night and in fog it was a menace beset by violent storms and dangerous rocks that over the centuries littered shipwrecks around the coastline. The Cape of Good Hope. So named by Portugal's King John II, this area has captured the imagination of European sailors such as Dias, who first named it the Cape of Storms in 1488, and later in 1580, Sir Francis Drake, who called it the fairest cape in all the world. Rich in cultural and natural heritage, this is one of the top tourist destinations in South Africa. Due to the variety of wildlife that occurs here, it is the only section of the Table Mountain National Park that is fenced, and visitors should look out for eland, red hartebees, bontebok and zebra. Be sure to visit the Buffelsfontein Visitor Center that showcases all the plants and animals to look out for in a particular season and is full of informative signage. Centered around the Langebaan Lagoon, the West Coast National Park covers 30,000 hectares of wetlands, strandveld and unspoiled coastline. The 5,600 hectare lagoon ranks as a wetland of international importance and supports up to 50,000 water birds at times. There may be as many as 30,000 migrant waders present. For birding enthusiasts, there are two bird hides overlooking the lagoon and one in the salt marshes. Nearly 250,000 coastal seabirds are attracted to the five islands in Saldanha Bay. Malchus Island is one of only six breeding colonies of the Cape Gannet, with up to 20,000 breeding pairs, while the Saldanha-Langebaan area supports 12% of the world's population of the African black oyster catcher. The focal point of the park headquarters at Geelbeek is the Cape Dutch Manor House, dating back to the 1860s. The Namakwa reel dance has its origins from the early Khoisan people from the Cape. It is also known as Dinkapara by the Nama. The reel is extremely energetic and has a difficult footwork rhythm. It is the oldest form of dance in southern Africa. The Nama's forefathers, the Khoisan, used to dance around the fire after a successful hunt or harvest, and most of the reel steps are also danced in a circle. Nkapara is known for its quick and energetic steps, and the Afrikaners named it the reel dance for its comparison to the Scottish reel. Tangwa Karoo. Tangwa Karoo National Park is situated on the southern boundary of the Northern Cape, with the Rogerveld Escarpment in the east, Cederberg in the west, and Klein Rogerveld Mountains in the south. Just a four-hour drive from Cape Town brings you to this truly unique national park. Situated in the succulent Karoo biome, the area is renowned for its rare and endemic plant species, rich bird life, and landscapes that will take your breath away. From the sheer cliffs of the Rogerveld Escarpment to the moonscapes of the Tangwa Desert. Just offshore, Bird Island is home to between 4,000 and 6,000 breeding pairs of Cape Gannet. The island is connected to the mainland by means of a breakwater in 1959. Every turn in the road paints an unforgettable picture. Valleys filled with Namakwaland daisies and other spring flowers that pulse with sheer energy and joy. During early August and September, seemingly overnight, the dusty valleys of Namakwaland are transformed into a wonderland carpeted with wildflowers. With its winter rainfall, Namakwaland is home to the richest bulb flora of any arid region in the world, and more than 1,000 of its estimated 3,500 plant species are found nowhere else on Earth. Springbok lies in a deep, low plain between rugged mountains, about 600 kilometers north of Cape Town. It is the commercial and cultural center of Namakwaland, located directly on the N7, which connects the Cape and Namibia. Springbok is a prosperous town with about 15,000 inhabitants. The main income is generated from tourism, mining activities, commerce and farming. The Diamond Coast, as the area has become known, holds a beauty and mystique of its own, with its cultural diversity and mineral mining. These two towns and the diamond mines that support them offers an interesting insight into the lifestyle of the modern miner. A established as a small vessel harbour and railway junction in 1854 for the copper mining industry. Port Nolloth's narrow, shallow entrance makes it unsuitable for ore carriers. It is instead a centre for the small-scale diamond recovery and crayfishing industries, and the only resort on the Diamond Coast. After diamonds were discovered along the west coast in 1925, Alexander Bay was known for its mining activities. The resulting diamond rush led to the Diamond Coast Rebellion of 1928. At the mouth of the Orange River, the town is no longer a high security area and no permits are needed. The town takes its name from Sir James Alexander, who shipped the Richtersveld copper ore he mined in barges down the Orange River for export from this bay. Richtersveld. Make a startling discovery upon closer inspection when the mirage dissolves into the human-like half-maids, half-person, and the harsh environment proved to be a treasure chest containing the world's richest desert flora. Miniature rock gardens, perfectly designed by nature, cling precariously to cliff faces. Tiny succulents, mere pinpoints against the backdrop of surreal rock formations, revel in the moisture brought by the early morning fog rolling in from the cold Atlantic Ocean. Traditionally known as the Gariep River, the Orange River is the longest in South Africa, 2,200 kilometers. Its source is high up in the Drakensberg mountain range in Lesotho, and it flows into the Atlantic Ocean at Alexander Bay in South Africa. The Orange River is responsible for transporting diamonds and creating the deposits that can be found along the Namibian coast. At 500 meters deep and over 160 kilometers long, the Fish River Canyon is one of the largest canyons in the world. There are remarkable photographic opportunities here. World's oldest desert, reported to be the oldest desert on Earth, the Namib is approximately 80 million years old. Completely devoid of surface water, it is bisected by several dry riverbeds and is characterized by extensive undulating dunes. The Sahara may be larger and Gobi more isolated, but the Namib is the very oldest. Klein Aus Vista campsite is situated just outside the quaint town of Aus and en route to Luderitz, Kolmanskop and the coast. Only 20 kilometers from the wild horses of Namibia. The desert horses that roam the arid plains between Luderitz and Aus are a bit of a living legend. The feral animals roam an area of about 350 kilometers and radiate an irresistible sense of freedom. The quiver tree is a curious plant. The aloe species grows 3 to 5 meters tall with a thick silvery trunk that branches out several times to form a rounded crown of many green tips. The bark is very smooth and cracks in age to form intricate patterns. In the winter months, aloe digitoma produces bright yellow flowers. The quiver tree forest, 14 kilometers northeast of Keetmanshoop, is one of very few spontaneous forests of this kind. Giant's playground is packed with large dolerite boulders that are stacked upon each other like a giant baby has used them as building blocks. The boulders are between 160 million and 180 million years old and form a maze that is interesting to explore. Namibia's largest dam lies close to the origin of the Fish River. Close to Mariental and about 250 kilometers south of Windhoek, Hardtop Game Reserve wraps around the 25-kilometer Hardtop Reservoir. Situated in the tiny town of Solitaire, the campsite has shade, braai facilities, a swimming pool and shop. The town has a great bakery, fuel station, minor vehicle repair station, small shop and post office. The area around Solitaire has many great hikes, 4x4 trails and mountain passes to explore, all offering excellent views over the surrounding area. Solitaire is conveniently en route to either Walvis Bay to the north or Sossus Vlei to the south. Namibia will soon be the only continental country to protect its entire coastline. The Namib Skeleton Coast National Park will span 1,570 kilometers along the entire Namibian coast from the Orange to the Kunene River. Covering 107,540 kilometers, the park will be the sixth largest terrestrial protected area and Africa's largest national park. The narrowest spot on the Skeleton Coast Park will measure 25 kilometers inland, and the widest part will reach 180 kilometers from the coast to the Naukluft Mountains. A marine conservation area adjacent to the coast extends Namibia's conservation efforts offshore. The Ngara fruit, a wild melon that grows in the Kuseb riverbed, is unique to the Namib Desert. For more than 1,000 years, it has been the traditional staple food of the Topnar or Ayunin people, one of the oldest communities of Namibia. The Namib Desert follows the coast of Namibia for approximately 2,000 kilometers. It varies in width from 80 to 200 kilometers where it meets the Namib Escarpment. The most important climatic feature of the Namib Desert is its sparse and highly unpredictable annual rainfall, which ranges from 5 millimeters in the west to about 85 millimeters along its eastern limits. Our aim with this trip is drive across the desert from east to west, experiencing the dramatic change in the environment. From Homep, we head southwest into the Sand Sea. On the way to Conception Bay, massive dunes are negotiated. Once again, ever-changing scenery and beautiful landscapes are enjoyed. Driver's skills are bound to be improving as the dunes offer greater and greater challenges. The dune straits are massive, and the dunes themselves even more impressive. Most are in excess of 150 meters high, enjoying the unique thrill of desert camping. The exploration of Namibia by Europeans commenced from this coastline as early as 1485, although the inhospitable Namib Desert barred access to the interior. Probably the first European to set foot on Namibian soil was the Portuguese explorer Diogo Cao or Diogo Cam, followed by Bartholomew Dias 2 years later, on 8 December 1487. This date represented the holiday of Maria's Conception. Therefore, the bay received the name Santa Maria da Conceição, Conception Bay. Today, you will most likely see vast flocks of birds drive past Cape Fur seal colonies, visit the wreck of the Edward Bolland near Conception Bay, and see various relics dating back to the diamond mining era. In November 1914, all the people in this area were requested to stop operations and to proceed to Swakopmund. This order came as a result of an expected invasion of Allied troops. This part of the journey is something history buffs will particularly enjoy. Keep a lookout for wandering ghosts. Sandwich Bay. The dune belt opens up between Mayo Bay and Conception Bay, but immediately after Conception, it stretches right onto the beach. From Conception Bay, you will be driving on the beach. Scenery is truly magnificent. You will also experience driving freedom, big time. We are heading northwards towards Sandwich Bay, passing the wreck of the Chanrui and negotiating the famed Langevant, where massive dunes come straight down into the sea. There are only two or three places in the world to see this natural phenomenon. Due to the tides, there is only a very limited time span to negotiate this stretch of beach. The Walvis Bay Lagoon is one of the most important wetlands for coastal birds in southern Africa. Flamingos form pink clouds above the lagoon, and pelicans abound. The importance of the lagoon was recognized by the Ramsar Convention in 1971, and birders still flock to this beautiful coastal habitat. The scenic Walvis Bay Lagoon is not only popular with birds. The Walvis Bay Lagoon and the harbor makes this coastal town the perfect place for water sports and marine cruises. Boat cruises in the Walvis Bay environs have almost guaranteed sightings of dolphins and seals. In season, southern right and humpback are common. As Southern Africa's most important wetland for coastal birds, the Walvis Bay Lagoon was declared a Ramsar site and is home to large flocks of pelicans and flamingos. Once upon a time, 150 to 185 million years ago, a two-legged dinosaur left his three-toed footprints about 29 kilometers southeast of what is now Kalkveld. Today you have to pay a small fee and sign a visitor's book in order to see these dinosaur footprints at the Ochihanaporero farm. The collection of shallow tracks in the rock surface was declared a national monument in 1951. The world's fastest land animal, the cheetah, can reach speeds of 70 miles per hour. The most specialized member of the cat family, the cheetah, also is the most endangered cat in Africa. Join Dr. Laurie Marker, the Cheetah Conservation Fund, and the plight of the cheetah. Etosha National Park is home to a wide range of Southern Africa's wildlife, including all the big carnivores and five rare or endangered species: black rhino, Hartmann's mountain zebra, black-faced impala, roan antelope, and the tiny damara dik-dik. The wildlife is prolific, and Etosha has every right to proclaim itself as one of the world's preeminent wildlife areas. Game viewing in the park is relatively easy due to the man-made waterholes and the large sparsely vegetated pans. The bushland surrounding the pans is difficult to see through, but there are enough clearings, pans and waterholes to usually allow for some sightings. Namibia has protected its game reserves against poaching, so there are large herds of elephants, antelope and other herbivores. Be warned, Popa Falls are not falls at all, rather a series of rapids, waterways and islands on the Okavango River. When the river is low, the highest visible drop is about 3 meters. There is a walkway into the middle of the river. After this, you are free to scramble over the rocks in the middle of the river. At this point, the channel is about 1 kilometer wide, with the river split into a series of channels making their way through the rocks.
This is a place we used to show tourists, the Big Popa Falls, and my name is Simon, and I'm a guide, transport tourists come here to the Big Falls, and that's the aim.
The northeastern track of Namibia is an isolated finger that points towards the heart of Southern Africa. Fed by a multitude of rivers, the Caprivi Strip is an area with a very different character to the rest of the stark Namibian landscape. On the border of four neighboring countries lies a lush and untouched wilderness that gives explorers at heart a playground full of big game in the perfect African setting. The Victoria Falls are an enormous curtain of water, about a mile wide, falling 108 meters into a narrow gorge below. In the wet season, the spray created can rise up an incredible 400 meters, and the falls are an impressive raging torrent. The spray from the falls can sometimes be seen from kilometers away. It's no wonder that the local name Musi Uatunya means the smoke that thunders. In the dry season, the view of the falls is unobstructed by spray, and it's possible to see little islets in the river below. The Victoria Falls Bridge was commissioned by Cecil John Rhodes in 1900. Although he never visited the falls and died before construction began, he expressed his wish that the railway should cross the Zambezi just below the Victoria Falls. "I should like to have the spray of the falls over the carriages." A truly relaxing safari through the African bush atop the world's largest land animal, the African elephant. Enjoy this amazing experience as you ride the elephants with your maud and the guide who take you on a journey packed with interesting information about the gentle giants as well as the bush around you whilst taking in the sights and sounds of Mother Nature. A pride of four adolescent lions, comprised of two of the rare white lions and two tawny lions. Walk with the kings of the African bush in this amazing and unique experience with no restraints. Just you and the lions. A one-on-one personal and intimate walk right next to you. Considered one of the best stretches of commercially run river in the world, Botoko Gorge provides one of the most intense sensory thrills imaginable. Its 23 whitewater rapids and striking scenery deep within the sheer black cliffs afford the adrenaline junkie a wild roller coaster ride along a route carved over millennia by the Great Zambezi. If you are interested in the optional helicopter flight, 12 minutes or 25 minutes, we endorse the following operator only: Zambezi Helicopters, care of CAA Zimbabwe. Your leader can help you arrange this activity. Photos of Africa and team sincerely hope that you have enjoyed this virtual trip from Cape to Vic Falls with all its beauty and splendor. We invite you to book your seat and make it a personal experience to tread under the gigantic Table Mountain and surroundings and to feel the cool spray on your skin from the smoke that thunders.